So we also have this beautiful stone seawall here around the island. We're also going to see a couple statues as we go by. Look pretty carefully, you can see their eyes and their mouths are painted red. That's said to ward off evil spirits and not in form of ghosts or evil hockey players or anything like that. That's said for the evil alcohol spirits back in the Polish. They would hate lanterns in the mouth of the statues. To let the smugglers know, they would see dreaming evil spirits across. Now our last mansion here at the head of the island is Windleaf. It's the last mansion built a millionaire row for U.S. involvement in World War I. Completed in 1917 by the Kellogg family from Battle Creek, Michigan. St. Kellogg family, we brought you your frosty flake cereal this morning. Sold about 5 years ago by the Hasseltine family from Scottsdale, Arizona. Donald Hasseltine made his fortune by working for Wonder Bread for a number of years. Actually holds a patent for the little rubber twist dot to use a bag for your bread shot. So as we turn back around here to the main shipping channel, coming up here to our left, you're going to see the headquarters of the United States Coast Guard for the Thousand Islands. This is Wellesley Island, here to our left, the second largest island in the Thousand Islands, the largest American island. Beautiful state up there to our left is Coral Hall. Prussia, which is a nature of worked at a small hotel in New York City after he arrived, worked his way up to that hotel, moved down to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, which he got a management job at Melvin Stratford Hotel. While working there, met his true love at first sight and his future wife, Louise. Once the two were married, they took up management of the hotel's team. A couple years afterwards, they also took up management of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York City. Matthew George purchased Hard Island and built the castle. He realized he still had some money left over, so with the money he had left, he decided to buy that small island right there. That's called Hub Island, or just Ruby Island. The story goes, George bought the island, built that little cottage for the second love of his life, his mother. So we're going to see a couple different buildings on Hard Island. Right at the head of the island is the large Ruby Island. That'll be the former entranceway to the island. Building islands like giant sandcastles, Ulster Tower, also known as a children's playhouse. Inside there, there's a two-lane bowling alley, a ping pong room, a billiard room, and a small balcony. The building was designed to help George and his children stay there while spending time on the island. The main castle stands 6 stories tall, has 148 rooms, 30 bathrooms, 32 fireplaces. It can comfortably fit 25 families on board, each of the families with their own restroom and their own fireplace. Also features 365 windows, one for every day of the year, and the first Otis elevator, an indoor in-ground swimming pool, located north of New York City. The last building at the tail of the island is the Pump House, Power House. It's also known as the Clock Tower. Back in 1904, it had a gas and a diesel generator. The generators pump enough power to not only power the castle, but all the other buildings on Hard Island. At the time, it even could have powered the entire village of Alexandria Bay. That large wooden building back behind the island is the Old Castle Yacht House. Built by George, the house has a fleet of 48 vessels. Some of the original 48 are still in the yacht house today. So George Bolt, he purchased Hard Island in 1899 for $10,000. Changed the original spelling of the island from H-A-R-T, after its first owner, Congressman E.K. Hart, to H-E-A-R-T. We even had parts of the island itself blasted away, so it resembled more of a Valentine's Day party. Construction of the castle itself began in August 1900. It was scheduled to end on February 14, 1904. That was a very important date. Not only was it Valentine's Day, it was also Louise's birthday and their wedding anniversary. Well, on January 7th, when the castle was approaching 95% complete, a telegram was received from New York City. What the telegram read was, "All work must stop, everyone must lay down their tools, and leave the island immediately." Louise is dying, signed by George Bolt. Louise Bolt passed away at the age of 43 due to consumption. Today he was heartbroken. George was completely heartbroken, and he vowed to never step foot on the island again. He also asked his children to never step foot on the island again. So the castle was at their dominion over 70 years. During World War II, a lot of the steel was taken out of the castle to help the war effort. In the 1960s, early 70s, the castle saw a lot of vandalism take place. It was in 1977, the Thousand Islands Bridge Authority stepped up and purchased the island off the Bolt family, holding one U.S. dollar. The Bolt family had three stipulations with the deal. The first was that nobody ever spent one night inside of the castle, because they never had a chance to. The second was that it be open to the public and it serves as an open museum. So all the money made by the castle goes directly back into the castle for restoration projects. The third is that in honor of Louise, it never passed 95% complete, because she never got to see her grand castle in its complete form. Today, the Thousand Islands Bridge Authority still own and operate Hard Island. They put back an estimated $40 million back into the property for restoration projects over the years. Those restoration projects continue to this very day. Thank you. famously sold for just $24. The local slot is 42, just like this one. So not under the deal, they all started to call it Manhattan Island. Eventually, that name didn't catch on, so we've been calling it Manhattan Island over 160 years. The smaller island, little brown cottage, green metal roof, is Coyote, also known as Togo Island. It's owned by Scott Carter, who's a retired designer from Rayman. After he retired from Rayman, he spent a lot of time on the island because he's a pretty avid fisherman. A lot of the times he was bending over to pull fish, though, with his sunglasses, and slip right off his head, and fall into the water, and they'd sink down to the bottom. Is everybody's winner of Rayman's for freaking quality sunglasses? Okay, freaking price tag comes along with that quality, though. So Rayman's even $200 a pair. Carhartt lost 10 pairs in one summer. That's almost $2,000 he spent on sunglasses. All those sunglasses sitting at the bottom of the river. So he didn't want to spend all that money on sunglasses every summer. They knew he was just going to lose. So he sat down in his garage the winter afterwards, put all that knowledge and skill to a good use. And he created a new type of sunglass frame. The new sunglass frame floats in the water. So he decided to patent the floating sunglass that he named them after the island. So they're called Coyote Eyewear. You'll notice, pretty popular style sunglass here in the Thousand Islands because they can float. All your crew members represent Coyote because they're pretty handy for us to have because we're in the water every day for work. We even have a small selection of Coyotes right in the concession stand if you want to take a look at them. You'll notice they are the same Rayman designs, same Rayman quality. Very big point for Carhartt, though, was making them a lot more affordable than what Ray-Bans are. So we sell Coyote Eyewear for just $20. So if you're interested, you can go down and talk to Liza, Shelby Picado here. Now's a great opportunity to go see her at the concession stand, maybe use the bathroom, or just walk around and stretch your legs. I can take a break from the tour. I'll be talking for quite some time now. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. Pick the tour back up about